Ready to get back in our Father's Word, Philippians. Even as Ephesians brought forth grace, basically, Philippians brings forth joy. We do not have so much of the various clashes of religion because it was not a town of commerce or a seaport or where you had a lot of mixing and so forth. They were pretty well followers that had taken the church to heart and about 11 years before and had really helped it. And this gave Paul, and rightfully so, because his trial, it couldn't have happened at a better time. His trial is approaching in Rome, where he's in prison. But here he has this group of people that give him great joy because they've helped that word. They haven't changed it. They've let God's word speak. And he's very happy with them. As a matter of fact, he paid them quite a compliment. He said, you know, I'm getting on along here, and it's one thing to be with God. It's something else to be with you. And the fact that they gave him great joy at this time, we should all be appreciative of, because it lifted him, even as though the Holy Spirit would not. But we see with the opening verse, where we're going to pick it up in verse 24 and 5, you can see Paul's love for these people and the joy that they brought him. So having said this, with his trial approaching and he not knowing whether he's going to die or live at the hand of the Romans, he continues on. Chapter 1, the great book of the Philippians, verse 24, and it reads, with that word of wisdom from our Father Yeshua, nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. It's better that I stay on for you, that we continue our teaching, that we grow familiar with the Word of God and enjoy this fellowship, this labor of love. Verse 25, and having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for your furtherance and joy of faith. And there's that word, there's that word joy again. What a display of love, Christian love here. That with his problems and tribulations and everything, he's still looking forward to being with them in the fellowship of the Lord Jesus Christ. That fact of knowing the Holy Spirit is there and is touching. Verse 26, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. That, again, rejoicing brings forth that word joy again, that it is more abundant in Jesus Christ. This, we're seeing a lack of problems here. We're seeing unity and oneness in Christ, and it is a beautiful thing. Verse 27, only let your conversation, this is to say, let your Christian behavior be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. You set that example. Your credibility is important. That whether I come and see you or else be absent, if I don't make it, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit. You don't sway. You don't give way to ignorance, false teachings, but that you stand fast in the word, with one mind striving together for the faith of the gospel. The word striving here is sunatleo, which means to actually wrestle together for that goal, for that victory, to press forward together on the same team for a team victory. Verse 28. And in nothing terrified by your adversaries. Who are the adversaries? Satan's own and those that are misguided. Which is to them an evident token of perdition. That means destruction. But to you of salvation and that of God. Who is the Savior? God himself through the Son. to truth and following and working together and working against the adversary means that we find that salvation, which is to say eternal life. But to the other side, those that are on the side of the adversary, instead of salvation, eternal life, it's destruction. It's hell. And it's that pointed, and it's that final concerning when that time, that dispensation of time of Revelation chapter 20 closing verses transpires. Verse 29, "For unto you it is given," that means given freely, "in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake." Now, a lot of people, you think in following Christ, well, that's, everything is just lovely and beautiful, and it's wonderful to serve the Lord. Hey, there's some thorns out there, friend. When Christ taught the absolute truth and nothing but the truth, there were many came against him that wanted to stone him, curse him, move against him. And did he suffer? Well, how about Paul even for doing the same thing? I mean, he had been shipwrecked, beaten, and even thought a time or two he was going to die. But God always brought him through, always could see that he made it. But to suffer for Christ is a beautiful thing. That is to say, what do I mean by that? Well, in this particular generation, Christians are snickered at many times, or made light of in the media. But then, what is the media? They're a bunch of line readers. They have absolutely very little judgment on their own. Someone has to put on a cue card what it is that they're to say. And whichever company controls them, that's their persuasion. And it is taught them that they are to stay away from religious thoughts and so forth. But if you leave God out of an equation, most people are intelligent enough to know that if you leave God out, you're going down. It's all, friend, it's all downhill. There is no uphill if you leave God out of the equation. So that's what makes it a pleasure to suffer for him. If it comes along, who cares? Well, it might offend them. Who cares? You know, this is Satan's main trick, is working on Christians' minds, causing them to have to fear if they should offend someone, that you would lose your credibility. Well, I'm going to tell you something. We don't have much credibility with the devil already, and I don't figure doing God's work you're going to gain any credibility with him. And quite frankly, I could go a step further and ask you, why would you want to be credible to him other than a servant of the living God, his enemy? So don't worry about offending those that are our adversaries. They're evil, and some of them might be good people at times, but if they try to, and as long as they leave us alone, that's well and good. But if what we do in serving God offends them, that's tough turkey, friend. I could care less. Well, that doesn't sound very Christian. Oh, yes, it does. We make a stand, and that's what you're supposed to do also. You're supposed to stand for something instead of being a wimp, a wet noodle that'll sway with the flow whichever way it goes. God can't use people like that. He can only use those that go against the adversary, that are going into perdition, whereby you can find eternal life by doing God's business. Next verse, please. Verse 30. "Having the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here to be in me." That conflict of what? Of the conflict mentioned back before, the synatheleo, which is to say the striving to serve God correctly, and at the same time as it would read in that same verse 27 concerning the striving, that you would let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel. In other words, that your credibility becometh Christ. It doesn't become Christ for you to allow Satan or his little negative thinking people that want to remove God's name from everything to have a victory over you. Hey, listen, let me tell you something. They're the biggest fakes that ever came along. So you need boldly to make a stand for something, to amount to something, to let God find pride in you. And as Paul says, having the same conflict which you saw in me, make sure that you take your place and part. Okay. Can you do that? You got a pretty bad place being a Christian, you're going to have a hard time being a Christian if you're not willing to take your place and part. Well, what is my place and part? Standing against the adversary. Ultimately, it will come to the fulfillment of Mark chapter 13 and Matthew 24 to witness against the spurious Messiah, the false one. Always having the gospel armor on and in place is the prior book to this. Ephesians chapter 6 tells you, especially your girt or belt is supposed to be the word of God, where you're equipped with it and it holds your britches up. Otherwise, you're going to be embarrassed. God's word will always sustain you. God's word will always help you protect your credibility. God's word will always let you behave well toward the teachings of Jesus Christ, because his word conditions you, prepares you, and you have a discipline within that. This is why disciples, which comes from our word discipline, are discipline themselves in the word of God, whereby they know what befalls them, what will befall them, and how to handle it. They taking their place. Paul says, look, you know I'm in this fight, and you see what, here I am, I'm in prison for teaching the word of God. Fortunately, in this great nation of ours where we have the First Amendment, that we have freedom of religion, that it's a little bit impossible for someone to make it stick as long as they are legitimate in teaching the word of God. Chapter 2, verse 1. Always serve God, amount to something, be a Christian. Chapter 2 and verse 1, and it reads, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if there be any appeal here, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies. I feel that's kind of a poor translation. It means inward affection. Do you have any inward affection? That is to say, love of Christ right from the very inside of your very being. That you're not a fake. That you have that appeal. That you're willing to live by it. Willing to stand for it. You must understand, there are enemies in this world. Satan is the prince of the air. And if you be a servant of Christ, he's going to try you. But you must always remember that your Heavenly Father has given you power over all of your enemies, including the adversary. You don't have to put up with it. Get tough. Get right. And let your conversation or your behavior be fitting as a Christian. What you could sum this first verse down to is listen and obey. Obey Christ. Verse 2, fulfill ye my joy, there's that word again, that ye may be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. That means get along. There is, you know, the word is sufficient unto those that follow Christ. The word is wonderful. That love is there. There is no contention. There is no contention when, you know, God has servants that have different obligations and duties. That's well and good. But they still get along in the Word because there's only one Word. There's only one Savior, and that Savior is Christ, Jesus Christ. Verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. You're going to have people that are going to want to have the spirit of argument, strife, always fighting this, fighting that. Vainglory is ego trips. But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. You know, I suppose one of the a mature Christian, one of the first things they learn that none of us are perfect, and that we have to help each other. We have to all strive. And when you know that none are perfect, but at the same time we know the Word of God is perfect, and we know that the Word of God strengthens us, the Word of God brings us up. So this is why that you want to beware of strife and vainglory. Vainglory is ego trips of, I know a better way than the Word of God, or I have a better way of teaching the Word of God. And, you know, usually when one teaches the Word of God with clarity and with humbleness, what does that mean? Describe humbleness in the sentence structure that you just stated. It means giving the Word the credit. Giving the Word of God the credit for the building. Giving the Word of God the credit for touching people, for leading people. Don't try to take it upon yourself. That won't fly, friend. It's the Word, because the Holy Spirit touches and anoints and leads and guides people through the Word, and Christ is that Word. Verse 4, let not every man on his own thing, don't let a man just have himself as the only thing he's interested in. Don't you care anything about God's children? But every man also on the things of others. In other words, we're a family, a Christian family. And you can't just think of self. This is where vainglory kind of gets a little kickstart. What you do in teaching God's Word, you don't do it for self. At least I hope you don't. You do it for others. And let's just say a little word about teaching God's Word. A man that teaches God's Word without going to the level or teaching on different levels in the simplicity, let me repeat, in the simplicity in which Christ taught, deceives himself and will deceive others. God's Word makes room for itself. God's Word grows into man and becomes a part of him if he finds that salvation. It puts within him the ability to recognize the adversary at any time he raises his little head. And that caring for others, probably the main strive, the main point being, many people are going to be deceived before too long. They already are. But pull as many from the fire as you can. Why? They're children of God. And that's why God sent his elect to this earth, was not to make some big name for themselves, but to help the children. And when God gives you a platform, utilize it to see that it is God's Word that is pressed forward, for it is the power and the strength that changes lives and gives people a purpose. A being A human being has great difficulty living without a purpose. Life would be pretty boring without a purpose. Very boring. And you will always find your purpose in God's Word, not with man, but with God's Word. Next verse, please. Verse 5. Let this mind, or let this attitude be in you, which all was also in Christ Jesus. Try as best you can to stick with that word, and let the mind of Christ be within you as nearly as possible. We know that none of us can have the full mind of Christ because he was God walking the earth with us. But at least we can strive to learn and to grow in his truth. Verse 6, who being in the form of God, now listen to me carefully, speaking of Christ, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God. He did not grasp or struggle with equality with God. And though God said himself, name him Emmanuel. Verse 7, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men, like any other man. I mean, you know, think of it. In the great parable, which I always consider it a parable when you take the more in-depth learning of Jesus washing the feet, being the servant of all. Because why? When you walk on the earth, you're going to get dirty. When you live in the flesh, you're going to get dirty. But it is Christ, the Savior, who can wash your feet to wash our sins away, who can even on this earth make us decent people. And he took on, even though he was God with us, Emmanuel, he saw fit to be the servant, to lead, to guide, to be responsible, to pay our debts of sin, that on repentance they're washed away, forgiven. In other words, he didn't play Mr. Vanity. He didn't say, you don't understand, folks. I'm the really only begotten Son of God. I mean, there's just one like me, and you better enjoy me while you got me. He never took that attitude. And if you're going to follow him, neither can you. You have to realize that it is the Word that we bring forth, the Word that we live under, in, with it around us even, teaching us, leading us, that he who had every right, if anyone ever did, to take a high seat, he chose rather to take the low seat while he was with us, to set the example in love of caring for the flock. Verse 8, and being found in fashion as a man, God said, let us make man in our image, and when you've seen the Son, you've seen the Father. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. He even further did this, unto death, even the death of the cross. I mean, criminals were on each side of him. And he suffered that for you. He did not whimper. He did not back up. He did not say, well, I think I'll put this off till tomorrow. No, he stepped forward. He did not open his mouth as it was prophesied in Isaiah 53 that he would not. That he, his body, would take the beating and we receive the healing. And the beauty of it is, as an example to us, I truly believe that while he was on that cross, his very presence and the humble way in which he taught Psalms 22 as well as other scriptures, that one of the malefactors was even converted into a Christian while he was performing this task on that cross. One makes a difference. He always felt that way. Verse 9, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, sitting at his right hand, and given him a name which is above every name, Yahshua, Savior, Yahweh, Savior, the way. Verse 10, that at the name of Jesus, that's just to say Yeshua, every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. And it will come to pass on the first day of the millennium, as it is written, every knee shall bow before Almighty God through the Son, Jesus Christ. It will happen. Will it last all that long? No, there'll be many going down and convert back, as it is written in Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What a fantastic statement, the full Godhead there. Verse 12, wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, not just when I'm there, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. This is misquoted, misstated by many people in saying you can work out your own salvation only through the Savior. Okay, that's what he's talking about. He's given you the Savior's title. He's given you the Savior's position, his humble attitude toward conversion. And you have to work that out with him. Talk to him. Let him know you love him. He paid the price. I guess the question is are we worthy? When you get yourself worthy and by repentance only, then you can work out that salvation. Then you can know that with fear and trembling that the almighty presence of God is your adversary. It's the one that looks out for you. What a comforting thought. What a time of joy. Verse 13, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. You got to remember that. If it's just to will, they don't cut it. You got to do also, to will and to do. A lot of people like to will. Oh, I will later. I will someday. I will get around to it. You got to be a doer. You got to know. You got to strike when the iron is hot. There comes a time when somebody needs a witness. And you got to lay it on them right then, just in time to set the example of what a Christian looks like, acts like, and states. And therefore, it is God which worketh in you. Do you understand that? It's our Heavenly Father that gives you the gift of being able to will and to do for your brethren. And this gives him good pleasure. That's why God created man. Last verse of Revelation chapter 4. For his pleasure, God's pleasure. Verse 14. Do all things without murmurings and disputings. Biggest waste of time. You know, this is something you have to clean up in the ministry occasionally. You can't put up with nonsense. You root it out. All they are is a bunch of troublemakers. Get rid of them, all right? And don't be bashful about it. They're not deserving. Verse 15, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation among whom ye shine as lights in the world. What a statement by Almighty God. Do you know what he's quoting from here? It is, especially in this last generation, the generation of the fig tree, that we know that the third that followed Satan are living right today. And that third were evil then, and I'm going to tell you something, they are today. And anyone that has a little bit of time on their age to their credit has observed this transpire as it's come to pass. It's not the same. I mean, mark this day, nothing will ever be the same again. And it's been that way for quite some time. But what is God quoting here in this, that it is a crooked and a perverse generation? It's something you need to know, and you should recognize it. It's the song of Moses. It's the song that God's own sing when we have the victory over the adversary. And it is the fifth verse of Deuteronomy chapter 32. And what does it say? Absorb it. Listen to me. Deuteronomy 32, the great song of Moses, which in Revelation 15, those that overcome the beast system know and understand and are even singing this song. But it says in this fifth verse, which was quoted by Paul, they have corrupted themselves. Their spot is not the spot of his children. They're perverse. They are a perverse and a crooked generation. And that generation, even today, walks among us, and it is more important. I mean, there's a time element. Let me tell you something. Underline in your mind the word nation, as Paul uses it here in the 15th verse. This word nation is spelled in the Greek G-E-N-E-A. It's a generation. It's a generation set aside. It's the generation of the fig tree. That's when this perverse, crooked generation would come to pass. So Paul has even dated this particular scripture for you in your mind, whereby you could not be deceived. I don't know. You know, you have a choice in this earth age. That's to serve God or to serve Satan or just to be a nobody. That's up to you. But stand for something. Do not allow people to try to remove our Father from us. Yeah, we'll just take the word God, the name of God, out of all that. Oh, no, you won't. Not on your life will you ever remove God from this nation, this generation. I guarantee it. The presence of God is far too strong in a nation that the very Constitution was taken from the Word of God. And nobody had better try to touch it, because God himself would see that things are handled. Meanwhile, we will, okay? The war is on, and we're going to win. Our Father's name will never be taken from us. He gave it to us, and it is here to stay. Well, that might offend some person. Tough stuff, friend. If God's name offends you, then go find you a hole, crawl in it, and do something. Because you're not going to take the name from us just because you might get a little wrinkled. You don't look too good anyway if you're against God. I guarantee you, a little wrinkle won't hurt you, okay? We don't care if it offends anyone. Why? Because God is love. And love spans many things in life. It also, love, tough love gets rid of things that hinder the lives of those that look for peace, because they're going to have that peace. All right, don't miss the next lecture. Hey, listen a moment, won't you please?